I'm going to call the House Education meeting to order. Chairman Coleman is in another meeting. He's going to be here in 15 minutes or so, and because of the very full agenda, we want to hear from as many people as possible. Want to go ahead and get the meeting started on time. At this time, I ask Chairman Nix to lead us an invocation. Chairman Nix.
Let's pray. Lord, it's a beautiful day outside, and we thank you for the beauty of your handiwork that we get to see on a daily basis. Father, make us aware of all blessings that we have and help us as we go into this meeting to look to you for knowledge and guidance that we might do the things that would be pleasing to you and be good for the children and teachers and parents in this state. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. All right, I'm going to do my best Brooks Coleman impersonation, which I am not. But do we have any folks here who are first time at a House Education meeting? Raise your hand. Certainly, somebody's been here not before. All right, well, welcome you guys. All right, how many teachers do we have here? That's always the most important. A lot of teachers. That's even more important. We really appreciate you guys coming. We really appreciate listening to what you're going to have to say a little bit later when we talk about Senate Bill 364. Just so you know, procedurally, we have seven bills today. The first six bills have already been heard in subcommittee, which means we've already taken testimony. We've already taken a lot of detailed work. And so we hopefully will get through those six bills fairly quickly. Get to 364, we will, at that point, move into a different matter of a full hearing where we will go over the bill and take testimony. So at that point, moving on, and if you need to sign up, is there still another sheet going over there? All right. Signing up for 364 only over there. All right, so this time we'll go to our first bill. It was actually a resolution, House Resolution 1253 by Representative Sharper. Representative Sharper, podium or table, whichever makes you happy.
Thank you, Chairman and members of the committee. House Resolution 1253, I'm just going to read it briefly. It basically was inspired by a young man that was killed in my area, Colton Shaw, and we're trying to get more dugout safety. So I'm going to read just the first section here. Encouraging the local boards of education, non-public elementary and secondary schools, governing bodies of charter schools and public recreation facilities to render instructions on dugout safety to youth athletes participating in the sport of baseball and to construct protective dugout coverings and for other purposes. So that's what we're trying to do, is just get it to where we got more dugout safety training. As a coach myself for like 10 years, you know, we really worked hard to teach the kids how to catch, how to throw and things like that, but we really don't go that extra effort to teach them about dugout safety, as far as paying attention while you're in the dugouts and things of that nature. So I would like to see us, you know, put this in place, encouraging a resolution.
Excellent. Chairman Nix.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We heard this yesterday. I think it's a good bill, and it is an encouraging resolution that is not a mandate. Right. And at the appropriate time, I would be willing to.
While you're on the mic there, what was the recommendation of the subcommittee?
Do pass.
All right. Thank you. Any further questions or comments from members of the committee? Hearing none, I will entertain a motion.
Make a motion do pass on House Resolution 1253.
All right. I got a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Mr. Sharper, you pass and go on to rules.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All righty. All right, moving on to House Resolution 1564 by Representative David Clark. Is he here? Do we see David? I see no David Clark going once, going twice. Move to the back of the line. Representative Douglas with House Resolution 1342. All right, my man. Can you pull that mic a little closer?
Testing. Okay.
Your podium might be better. Yeah, we've had problems with the table microphone. We go to the podium, it'd be awesome. You are.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Committee, for the opportunity to be before you today. I'm presenting House Resolution 1342, which basically urges Georgia school systems to increase recess time for our children. Since there is, this is where all of our schools' age kids spend majority of their day and time, it is very important and often influenced with life lessons. That's basically what the bill's about. And as I said in the committee yesterday, I've been involved in athletics all my life, and I think this is a worthwhile resolution to get our kids back going again. And I'm straight to the point. I don't want to read too much.
All righty.
If there are any questions, I would love to answer them.
I do have a few questions. Number 17, that's Representative Setzler, Chairman Setzler.
Hey, Mr. Chairman. Recess was probably my best subject in school. And is there any measurement about how much recess time we have across our schools? I was advising someone the other day that, you know, before we act legislatively, sometimes just measuring things and shining a light on something is helpful. And I'm not telling you all to have that in your resolution.
Right.
But do we have any visibility of what we're really doing at an elementary school level or a middle school level?
Right now, I think it's 0 to 30 minutes. But I've checked on it since the subcommittee meeting, and there is they break it down based on the counties on how much recess time is allowed. They don't have to do it, which I think that I'm trying to help change that, because the statistics show that our kids, high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, kidney and liver disease, all these things stem from low activity of movement and them catching obesity at a young age. And then it's 80% 80% chance if a kid is obese, there will be an obese adult.
Yeah, and Mr. Chairman, I don't want to belabor the point, but I would say that, you know, yeah, I'm concerned in my district in Cobb County. You look at the new neighborhoods that are coming online. Residential developers aren't building neighborhoods for kids to play outside. In many cases, they're paving paradise. They're putting in privacy fences. They've got a Bradford pear out front, and the house bakes in the Georgia heat most of the year. There's really not a very accommodating place for people to live and play, and sometimes recess is the best opportunity kids have. And I think it's you know, maybe in the future we're going to talk about measuring success in schools here within the hour. I think this is something that's worthy of measuring, and I would just encourage you, as you strike out on this, if I could be of any assistance to you, I think measuring what we're doing and providing light on it allows the community to get engaged, and I appreciate what you're doing.
Thank you very much.
All right, Chairman Nix.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is another bill that we heard yesterday and gave it a due pass recommendation. Had some great testimony, and we did look at this and talked about how important it is. There were some good statistics given that Representative Setzler didn't hear, but I think there's good reason for this. And again, this is not a mandate. It is requesting that this happen. And we even talked about the possibility, maybe at some future time, being able to do some pilot programs to be able to show that it does what it does, which I believe that it does. And again, I appreciate that. And at the appropriate time, I'd be willing to make a motion.
All righty. Representative Glanton, did you have no? All right. I think Representative Glanton was chomping the bit for the motion first. I'm going to recognize Representative Glanton for the purpose of a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At this appropriate time,
yes,
I'd like to make a motion to pass.
Do pass on 1342 LC 1110253. Any further discussion from the committee? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. All right, you pass and you go to rules. Representative, thank you very much.
Thank you much, Mr.
And
Chairman.
I will now turn the con over to the big chairman, Mr. Chairman Coleman. Actually, you told me to finish up some resolutions, so I'm having fun. All right, House Resolution 1564, Representative Clark, I did see him show up, so there he is. Awesome. Representative, I'm sorry when you came in late. We're making people go to the podium because this table microphone is really not good. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman, for hearing my House resolution. It's 1564, and it's encouraging local Board of Education and the governing body of non-public schools and the governing body of charter schools to adopt and implement a sudden cardiac arrest training. And just because I think it's been a huge passion of mine, because it's the number one cause of death in student athletes. It's estimated around each year around 10,000 student athletes or just students will drop dead from cardiac arrest. So I think it's something that we definitely need to implement and encourage. And a number of states have been passing this, and we are just one of the states that I think needs to, you know, step up and get this education going, because they say that 72% of all students that die from sudden cardiac arrest have symptoms. And so if we can just bring more awareness, have some education, then, you know, hopefully we can start catching it and bring the death count down.
Absolutely. Chairman Nix, what was the recommendation on this bill in subcommittee?
It was a do pass recommendation.
Yeah. Questions or discussion from members of the committee for Representative Clark? Seeing none, the chair will entertain a motion. Chairman, do you have a do pass? Do you have more information, Chairman Nix? All right. A motion and a second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Congratulations, Representative Clark. You can go on to rules with that one.
Thank you.
All right, we're into the Senate bills now. You want me to do these three and give it to you? All right. I'm having all kinds of fun here. All right, Senate Bill 329 by Senator Tippins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I've got three bills before you today, actually four.
Yeah.
329 is an initiative of the Lieutenant Governor. As we have expanded the high school options for high school students to have college and career preparedness, that program was initially anticipated to track the high demand career initiatives. As the economy has been unfolding, there are other areas that need to be expanded, and 329 does that in collaboration with the technical college, the industry partners in the state, and the local high schools. What this does is provide for rigorous coursework to meet the demands of the workforce. Also awards or makes scholarship programs through HOPE scholarships more seamless, that those students participating in these programs as they go on into higher ed, they will have been deemed to have met the rigor requirements for that coursework. This was heard in subcommittee, and I'll let y'all comment on that.
All right, excellent. I'm trying to remember, Chairman Nix, was this in your subcommittee too? It was in mine, all right? Yeah, that's what I thought. A lot going on here. Yes, our subcommittee did hear this bill, and we recommended do pass. So, Chairman Dixon, the question?
More comment to say thank the senator for this bill. Preparing our young people to move on after high school and either into more education or into a job situation, I think is a critical thing that we are about or should be about as a state. I'm in favor of this bill, and at the appropriate time would love to make the motion for due pass.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments from members of the committee? Chairman Setzler, is that right, 17?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just to the author, I wasn't in the subcommittee, so I'm. What in plain terms does this do? I mean, I understand the diploma piece; it meets the rigor requirements. But how would you summarize this and to a layman?
Well, I think any time you talk about extending HOPE scholarship, your question is always: are you doing this for someone who's been awarded a certificate for being a nail technician? I don't think that meets the rigor requirements. But I think in the technical fields, as we see today opening before us, the vast majority of the jobs are in technical areas of the state requiring advanced technical training. And I think it's a mistake to make the presumption that only those courses that should be counted as rigorous coursework are the ones that are considered to be college preparatory. When we talk about seamless education, I think the beauty of SB 2, we probably save kids from dropping out of high school because we got them into an area that they were more interested in earlier, kindled their interest, and as they went to maybe TCSG and technical areas, they found out they could be successful and realized the need for further education, which would be covered under the HOPE scholarship instead of HOPE grant. This opens that up, and it's left to the DOE, TCSG, and the industry partners to identify those areas that would constitute the type of rigor that all of us would expect to qualify for HOPE scholarship.
Chairman, since we're all add a little bit to that. Yeah, the lines 31 through 33 essentially say, instead of just where there's two technical college certificate programs, if the Technical College Board of Industry relate an equivalent program of skills needed for the workforce, that is equivalent to the two certificates. Some of these programs aren't formal certificates, as the senator pointed out, and so that I think is what gives them more flexibility to apply this to more areas.
So for example, question: my son took a computer science pathway when he was at Kennesaw Mountain High School and took classes on networking and things like that. Right. Could a computer networking class, right now that's not a HOPE class, but that it if it met the rigor requirements, that could be a HOPE class that gets HOPE credit. Is that what this does?
It could be.
Okay.
Yes.
Any further discussion from members of the committee? All right. Hearing none, Chairman Dixon, you have a motion?
Move to pass for Senate Bill 329.
All right. Senate Bill 329, LC 336416. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. All right. Mr. Tippins, who's carrying this bill for you in the House? Do we know?
I'm not sure.
You want me to do it?
You can.
All right, I'd be glad to.
Unless somebody else has been asked.
Has anybody else been asked? Anybody here on the committee? All right, I'll do it for now.
Okay, fine.
Okay.
I think Lieutenant Governor's office was going to get with some people, but it's fine with me, whoever wants to carry it.
If we want to change that before we turn the report in, just we'll let the Lieutenant Governor know.
I'll clarify that this afternoon. Okay. Ms. Munn could not make the meeting, but I'll find out.
Okay.
I think she's reached someone. Second bill I've got.
Senate Bill 348.
348. Again, this is an expansion of educational opportunities for high school students in the state. Lieutenant Governor has been a very strong proponent of college and career academies. At the time college and career academies were first conceived, the only structure that would permit that would be a charter school. Since that time, we have freed up flexibilities for local districts through waivers, both of the strategic waiver districts and the charter districts. All this does is add as a provision that a charter district or a strategic waiver district can initiate a college and career academy in the co-partnership with TCSG and USG. And it's just an expansion and really solves that problem of having to create a freestanding charter. These college and career academies still have governing boards. All the same regulations are still governed that the college and career academies currently have. These are good programs. If you visited in any of our academies, they definitely are meeting job requirements of our workforce.
One thing I will comment too is that this, without a doubt, will, I believe, increase the number of these we have in Georgia. I think they're a great success story in education. I know in my county, this bill is exactly relevant to our situation, and we're looking at doing a college and career academy in Forsyth County, and so I really do appreciate this bill. So questions, Chairman Dixon?
Yes, and I too support this bill. There are a few changes, minor changes, that I think need to be made so that it will be applicable to even more potential charter, or not charter, but college and career academies. In the interest of time for today, since we are likely going to have another meeting, I would ask if we can delay this one until that next meeting,
That's right.
Later this week, so I can have a chance to get with the author and do those, talk to him about those amendments.
The vice chair concurs that this is important legislation, but we need to get it right. But I'd like to go ahead and get other questions, let the committee vet any other problems, and then we'll let Chairman Dixon work out language with Senator Tippins, and then try to move that by Friday to make sure we got time and room.
That's fine.
All right, number 27 down there, Representative Tanner Waves. Any other questions or comments from members of the committee? This time, with the concurrence of the author, we're going to hold this bill until we get some technical changes from Chairman Dixon. But we do, I think, as a committee, really does want to move this as an important piece of legislation. All right, your next to last bill before we get to the big one, Senate Bill 374.
374 provides for a pilot program for 1 year for selected schools to be able to consolidate state, federal, and local funds in Title I schools to test for the increased effectiveness on meeting the needs of students. This is a pilot program. It lasts for 1 year, and this is completely within confines of federal law. It's permitted, and I believe this will probably show some positive results in the areas of flexibility and being able to apply resources where students truly have
the last one. All righty. Questions number 24, is that Chairman Nix? Yeah, what was the recommendation?
We heard that bill and we gave it a do pass recommendation.
Other questions from members of the committee about Senate Bill 374, Chairman number 17, Chairman Setzler?
Hey, Mr. Chairman, just again, question. So what I'm reading this to do is that Title I money that can be used outside of the specific school but might be able to be used better around the districts able to have that flexibility now is what this does?
I think this would be more in the particular schools where those funds are earned. I think a district could have that ability, but I think typically speaking, most districts view the restrictions that are put on how title funds can be spent. One particular school district, I talked with the superintendent, and they said they had title funds. They had sufficient funds, but they could not allow for summer programs that would really be more beneficial academically in their schools. And this is the type of pilot program you're looking at. Best, looking for more efficient ways to invest dollars that result in higher student achievement. Our schools are changing. We have different needs. I think you'll see in high-risk, low socioeconomic areas, this one area that you can do that, maybe take extended day, extended year funds, and apply them in a little bit different way than maybe what state guidelines or federal guidelines.
Senator, my understanding is a couple of these pilot systems are getting up, geared up, ready to go, and we need to make sure the law is clear so they can do this next school year. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Number 27, is that Representative Tanner?
If I read this correctly, they're going to report back the progress to this committee and your committee next year, but they're going to report on a monthly basis to the Department of Ed their progress. Is that correct?
I believe that's correct. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I think this is good legislation at the appropriate time. I'd make a motion.
All right. Representative Carter?
I just want to clarify that flexibility is an option, and I say that because with my budget, I have a book budget and I have a supplies budget for my classroom, and I cannot spend outside of, I can't buy more books than what I have book money for, or I can't. Is that flexibility an option? Is my only concern with the federal government in particular?
I think it is an option. I think the federal requirements have been relaxed that it would provide for this. And I think the purpose of the pilot is to determine the most effective way. Certainly the pilot would not be with individual school teachers, but would be with a district,
sure,
to pilot it in their district to come up with best practices.
Okay.
All right, Chairman Dixon.
Once again, I thank you for a bill. For folks who have never worked with a Title I budget in a school, the complexity and the just the sheer magnitude of the regulations that determine how you can spend that money, I think this will provide an opportunity to try some new things. And did you want Representative Tanner to go ahead with a motion?
Yeah, let's get Representative Tanner in on the action. Representative Tanner, recognized for purpose of a motion.
Move do pass.
All right, we have a do pass on lots of seconds everywhere. Senate Bill 374, LC 336534S. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. I appreciate it. Thank you, Senator. And the undercard is over, and the main event is about to start, and I will now turn it over to Chairman Coleman.
I think I'll let you just stay on.
You got to be kidding.
Did a good job. Once again, great to see everybody, and I know you introduced all the teachers in the crowd today, didn't you? So we're glad to have you all again, and glad to have you. And I want to be sure that everyone here today who wants to speak, that you've signed up. I have the sign-up sheet here. It looks like about 73 people. But we're going to let you speak today. Just to see if anyone that did not sign up, please let us know. If you'll come over here and see Shay. Hold your hand up, Shay. She'll be glad to take your name and let you sign up. There's something I feel I need to do before I start. You're always reluctant to do these things, but I'm going to do this because it really hurt me very much and it really bothered me very much. But I got a call this morning because one of our largest teachers' organizations, one I respect very much, sent out an announcement early on and claimed that the governor was strong-arming four of my committee members, me included, to see that this bill did not move. Even mentioned us by name, Mike Dudgeon, Randy Nix, Tom Dixon, and Brooks Coleman, claimed that we were doing all that. The press this morning, the first I knew of it, I got a call, the press called me. I said, that's not wrong, that's a lie, the biggest lie I've heard. I said, I haven't even talked with the governor or his staff. They called Representative Dudgeon, he said the same thing, Representative Dixon and Representative Nix said the same thing. I immediately demanded a retraction because I tell you, when you do something, you need to apologize for it. You need to apologize. I want to read you the apology. This really hurts very much. This morning, we have spoken with House Ed Chair, Representative Brooks Coleman, as well as Vice Chair, Representative Mike Dudgeon, both assured, I won't mention the name, that the committee intends to pass 364 this afternoon with relatively minor amendments. You can stop calling, and I had over 1,000 calls and emails we did together, and put yourself and pat yourself on the back for working to improve the educational experience for Georgia students. Thank you for your responsiveness to your call for action. You make a difference. They do make a difference. But they never one place said, we made a mistake. We accused four people wrongly. It was a lie. We apologize for doing that, but we do appreciate you doing that. That's all I have to say about the matter, as we always say, and that's it. And all four of us feel the same way. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Now we'll get on with the House bill. Thank you so much. And we respect these organizations very much. But, hey, when you do us that way, and we've done nothing wrong. That's not good. All right. Now, let's go. We're going to have, I'd like to ask Senator to, we now have on the agenda, and I don't have my Senate folder, Senate Bill 364. We'll be working on LC 336605S. So if I could ask Senator Tippins, if you'd come forward, and I'd like to ask Representative Dudgeon if he would come down, and I'd like for them to present the bill together. Is that right?
I guess so.
All right, I would like you to do that. All right. And let me have a copy. I need my folder. One of the bills. I think if y'all want to, you can just go to the table and sit there and relax. Well, or you can stay there if you'd like to, okay?
The
microphone's table is bad,
yeah,
so stay there.
Mr. Chairman, before you got here, we discovered the table microphone was a failure. So, Mr. Chairman, Senator Tippins presented this bill in our previous meeting.
Yes.
As obviously, his version of the bill went through the Senate committee, and there's been lots of information about the version that passed the Senate. So the LC 336605S is the House substitute. As you know, Mr. Chairman, this came about by several House committee members working over the past several days, looking at the legislation, putting our input in, and making sort of a consensus of the group. So this is not Representative Dudgeon's substitute. This is the House leadership's substitute, not the big leadership, but the Education Committee leadership. And so I'm just going to walk through what we've done with the bill. So Section 1, related evaluations. The old language from Senator Tippins had it only the alternate evaluation with the 30% and so forth was only available to systems that were a charter system or a strategic waiver system. The way that the House substitute is worded, it's available to all schools in Georgia, and that would include systems like Buford, who so far are selecting status quo. So it made it look like we changed more because council had to strike stuff and added it back in. From a procedural point of view, what we've done is just essentially made it apply to all school systems in Georgia, not just those under charter system and strategic waivers. When it comes to the actual evaluations, this starting on line 55 of the substitute, this is 55 is for basically governing the evaluations. This would start in the 2016 school year. And as we all know, for teachers today, it's 50% on the evaluation and 50% from testing. On 63-64, the student growth based on the annual assessment has gone from 50% to 30. The Senate version of the bill further had a subdivision of the 30 into a 20 on the state testing and a 10 on other measures, student growth measures that could have come from the locals. The House version just has 30% being on the annual state assessment. Professional growth, that's the remaining 20% we've just kind of taken out of testing is now added. That 20% is the same as from Senator Tippin's version of the bill. And that professional growth section is similar than that last section saying that related to the flexibility contracts about how to make those indicators. So then we go to the teachers of record without an annual course, the infamous SLOW section. Starting on line 75. Again, that goes down to 30% instead of 50. One thing that we added here at line 78 is that we'll call this the Chairman Amy Carter rule, that we wanted to make sure that SLOWs in law were emphasized around the teacher and not the student, and that there's been some systems, some areas who've taken the SLOW thing and thought that meant that every student in every class needed to have a SLOW if they didn't have an end of course test, and so that generated a proliferation of testing. And so in the theme of trying to reduce the number of tests, we basically said that the student growth is at least one measure from at least one classroom. And Chairman Carter shared in the last meeting that she teaches multiple classes, and she has one SLOW in one of her classes, opposed to blizzarding her with developing four or five different SLOWs per teacher. We've heard lots of stories of that. The House feels would greatly reduce the number of SLOWs. A little different than the Senate bill, there was also language in the Senate bill around alternate ways to do something different than the SLOW, like a median score from an achievement test that's general for the school, that's not specific for the teacher. That is not there in the House version of the bill. Professional growth, again, is the same. So again, you end up, if you take a 35,000 foot view, you end up again with teachers down from 50% on testing to 30. And I know that's been a huge point of emphasis from the many of the thousands of people that we have perhaps heard from. For administrators starting on 94, again, it takes their testing from 70% down to 40. And we, again, eliminate the subparts of the 40 similar to the teachers. But again, you're taking testing from 70 to 40. New language from the House that was not in the Senate version, line 110. Essentially, Representative Nix worked on this language to make sure that there are no quota systems being applied, that you're doing these evaluations on a teacher basis. We'd heard anecdotal reports of, well, there's not enough bad ratings here, therefore we got to go back and add some more bad ratings or whatever. Want to make sure that we're looking at individual teachers and we're not trying to do a quota to push ratings into a particular direction. The starting at 125 about classroom evaluations, that language is the same as the Senate version. It allows, it says multiple observations. It does not, as to point out as before, it doesn't say six. I know we've talked about six evaluations today. That six is in state board rules, not in either the existing law or in this exist or the current law. Also left the Senate language saying that a teacher with the highest two ratings, proficient or exemplary, that we want to say only two evaluations instead of more than that. So that's the same. We get down, so that kind of ends section one, which was around evaluations. The House did make substantial changes to the testing section. Much of what was in the Senate bill was eliminated. There are some key pieces, though, that were kept that I know that are very popular with the education community. Look at line 174. That is where we're getting rid of the social studies and science tests in 3, 4, 6, and 7. As we pointed out, if you look at the chart we looked at last time today, if you look at all the law between milestones and intercourse tests, the state mandates 32 tests over a career. By taking these 8 tests out in the science, social studies, and those 4 grades, that will reduce that number from 32 to 24. That, again, is consistent with when Senator Tippins' bill, and so that's there. The line 186 about the compass to acuplacer, that's kept. We did change around a little bit the language around the testing windows here in 193. The Senate version of the bill asked the locals to move their testing within 1 or 2 weeks of the end of the semester or the end of the school year, but it didn't have anything to do with the state board. And I know a lot of members of the education committee feel passionately about this, myself included. This is one of the bill that I'm particularly passionate about as a school board member. I saw, in my opinion, lots of wasted time after CRCTs were given in the middle of April. And then my kids saw every movie that Disney ever created when they were in elementary school after the April deadline went by. And I'm in a very high achieving school system. And also by cramming the test early, you're putting more pressure on the teachers to get this huge curriculum list done earlier in the year. So what we want to do is put the monkey back on the state board of the department to say, why can't you move that window closer to the end of the year? There may be issues with testing and grading. I've heard a little bit about it, but I think we need to send a strong message, and this basically mandate the state board adopt policies by the 2017 school year and report back to these committees about why they can't, if they can't move it. And then, of course, the locals would still be encouraged to go to the end of the year. If it's going to be end of the year tests, let's do it at the end of the year, and let's not do it at spring break. And so that was additional language there. We kept the auditing language there in 203. That's the making sure that we are making sure that any tests that we do at the state level or have a national third-party auditor do their validity. Section 3 was also from Chairman Nix's good work. There was concern about whether to add an appeal or things like that, and I think the committee and many of the people felt that an appeal per se really is not a place we wanted to go. However, we wanted to make it clear that if there was a procedural violation, if the procedures, which we call out in Code Section 22.210 about number of evaluations and how the process was going to work, if that process was violated by an administrator and going through the evaluation, the process was not followed, then that is grounds to take further action with the local school system. And so we added that in 211 to 213. But just to be clear, it's not an appeal to a rating. If you got a 3 and you thought you should be a 4 or so forth, there's no grounds for an appeal for a rating. This is a procedural grounds for someone to fix a procedural matter. Mr. Chairman, those were the changes. I know we've had further discussions with Senator Tippins about possible other sections of his bill that we may want to be re-looking at as a committee, but I'll take your guidance as to how we proceed from here.
Thank you, Representative Dudgeon. I'm going to take questions for you, then we'll go and let Senator Tippins come forward, and we'll have some other comments. All right, number 24. So if you let me out,
That's me.
Representative Nix.
Thank you.
Chairman Nix.
Just one important thing that you missed on that first page is the 90% attendance.
Oh, yes, I did. I'm sorry. I glossed right over that. Yes, so
line 21.
We went from 80% of the instructional days to 90. As Chairman Dixon pointed out, 90% sounds like a lot until you realize that's being absent for 18 days, which is a heck of a lot of time to miss in the classroom.
Teachers shouldn't be held accountable if they're not there, right? All right, number 26, that's all right.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really, really, really like this bill, and I really appreciate Chairman Tippins for bringing it up. I do have one question on the SLOWs. For the social studies and the science milestones, they would not be required to create a SLOW just because they had not done it in the test, in the end of year evaluation, right?
What's that? That's only high school. SLOW is really only involved in the high school teachers where you go into classes. The elementary teacher is going to be evaluated on some portion of the kids in the other part of the milestone.
So they would not have to do a SLOW.
That's right.
Okay, that's my understanding. I'll make sure that's right. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm hearing.
Wait a minute. No. We'll give you a chance to talk. I will allow you to make your comment. You're saying teachers are held accountable? Stand up and tell us where you're from and what grade.
I teach middle school in Cobb County, and we take slows all through middle school.
In elementary?
Grades 6 through 8.
6 through 8.
Not
okay.
Elementary.
All right.
Okay. So you're saying the middle school ones?
Yep. And they take, I don't teach elementary, but I'm hearing.
Yes. Same in
my
Holden.
Son has taken.
No. Elementary. Raise your hands. And I will call on you if I need you. Okay, we're going to get this clarified. Come to the mic. This lady's sitting right here. You have a comment?
Same as Colton. Katie Reed from Colton.
Yeah. All right. That's a local decision, right?
No.
Okay, no? Okay. All right. I will ask Superintendent Wood, could you comment on that about our...
What policy is causing slows
to happen
in middle school?
Our, Gary or
do you have any
Representative McGibbon? Mr. McGibbon, can y'all comment? Representative Superintendent Wood?
Anybody from the department? Trying to get the department to bail me out here.
Just stay there. Just let somebody comment on that. We're going to clear it up now. Not going to leave it.
Well, I'm not sure I'll clear it up, but I will comment on it.
May cloud it a little bit. That's all right.
A lot of it is depending on the local school system level. Like in Fulton County, being a charter system, they have some flexibility on how they do that. But it's my understanding that most school systems, as Representative Carter said, the high school and the middle schools deal with the slows in those content areas. And in elementary schools, there are some content teachers in elementary schools, and those would be the content areas that have the slow, that would not have the slows because they're measured in the content.
All right.
And Representative Belton's question, I think, was if we remove the state assessments in the fourth and fifth and sixth and seventh, would they then have the slows? And yes, there'd have to be another student growth measure for them other than the state assessments that would not be required any longer.
Okay.
I got a comment.
May I ask Representative Carter, do you have a comment? I know she wanted to say something because you are doing that now, I think. All right, what's your number?
Number two.
All right, there.
I don't think we do it in my system, definitely, but I just go back to the state requirements that we got last week that did not have any SLOs on any grades below ninth grade.
That's right.
So my question to the state then is it not true that the state does not require those at first through eighth grade? Does the state require SLOs from the first through the eighth grade? The state DOE, does it require those SLOs?
All right, who wants to answer that?
I want to hear from the state.
All right, are you at the state? I want the state to answer that.
I have a clarifying comment, Mayor.
All right.
I will point out for elementary, at least, with our new language about only at least one growth measure from one class, assuming the elementary teacher isn't strictly a science teacher or strictly a social studies teacher, if their kids are taking reading and math and that's part of their classroom as well, then that test would be the one measure they needed if this new language passed. In other words, there would be not needed to have multiple things for the elementary teacher. If they were doing reading, math, and science goes away, they can use this test as the measure, I think is what our language is trying to say. But I have no idea the answer to your question about AMA.
Representative Carter had a question. Are you at the State Department? I want to get an answer from the state. Then we'll come to you, sir.
If I could ask, you said you got some guidelines, and I'm not sure what division or where that came from, so I'm trying to find that information out.
Do we still have that list? We all got a copy last week.
Representative Chandler had the list, yes. And Representative Clark had the list. You don't have it, okay.
And mine's in my office.
All right, yeah. Representative Clark has hers. Would this help? Here.
On our list on this list that it was my understanding last week in this committee meeting that this was created by the state DOE on the third through the eighth grade, there is no SLO listed. It lists the ELA, math, science, and social studies from, this is current state assessments, which I'm assuming this means milestones. It does not say that word, but four tests for the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth grades, but there is no SLO listed.
No mention of SLO.
No.
And I'm going to allow that gentleman there, stand up and give us your name. And tell us where you're from.
Executive Director of Accountability in Cobb County School District.
Come over here. What school district?
Cobb County School
District. Come on over here. Please, sir.
The SLOs are given.
Give us your name again, where back and where you're from.
Isan Katula, Cobb County School District.
All right, Cobb County.
I'm going to take the example of a teacher who's teaching physical education in seventh grade. They're not going to be in front of any milestone test, so therefore, we have to develop an SLO for them. Another teacher who's career tech, a computer class, that teacher doesn't have a milestone, so therefore, they're going to have an SLO developed for them.
So you're saying that in the middle schools, where they don't have one, you are being required to do one?
That's the current procedure, sir.
But you, okay, that's the, what you're doing in Cobb, and I see a head nodding for Fulton County. Okay, so they are requiring, is that K through 7 to do them. Okay, thank you. It's making it a little more interesting, all right? Thank you, sir.
So, Mr. Chairman, what I think that implies is that perhaps...
Now listen what Representative Dunn is getting ready to say.
You don't know what I'm going to say, which is...
Cool. I do. I know what you're going to say.
In my interpretation of where we're heading with this bill, that would mean an elementary school where they're already taking another milestone of something that the teacher would not have to come up with.
Not have to do that.
But if a science teacher in sixth grade science teacher who today is giving a milestone at the end of the year.
And that's it.
And now all of a sudden that does go away if this, we don't have an exact answer, if the state is mandating middle school SLOs, just like a career tech teacher or PE teacher, and all of a sudden the science teacher does not have a milestone test, then they, I guess, would fall under the SLO category is where we're headed. But I think elementary school, I think, with the one restriction, we would be okay with that.
All right. Any other questions? Any other questions before I start? I'm going to have Representative Tippins come forward and talk about his response and his reaction to the bill, what he likes, what he thinks, and then we'll take questions from him, and then we'll go to the audience, okay? Representative Tippins.
Senator.
I'm promoting him, Representative. Senator, come forward.
Please. I'm promoting, Lindsey. Congratulations.
Promoting him, I mean.
Mom always said, be careful who you hang around with. Hey, bad habits will rub off on you.
All right, Senator, we appreciate you, all right?
I didn't see the revised version until late last night, and I noticed that a good bit of what was in my bill had been removed. We had a meeting this morning. I appreciate the opportunity to visit with the House Education Leadership. I thought I brought you a real good bill. I understand it can be better. But I also understand there are some areas that are very, very important to this state and to me personally. And one of the areas that was completely removed was the K-5 mandate piece in reading and mathematics. We've talked this to death. Everybody talks about reading at third grade level. Problem is, as a state, we have not clarified what we expect. I think it's time to do that. I'm not real smart. I know there's a lot of songs that I don't understand. They had one time about leaving a cake out in the rain. I never did quite grasp that song. Some of y'all are laughing because you remember that song. It's been a long time. But I always understood Willie Nelson's songs. And one of them was, "My, ain't it funny how time gets away." I want to put this in perspective on K-5 and why it's so important to put this in this bill. I was elected to the Senate in 2010, and I came in 2011. And time does get away. It doesn't seem like this is the end of my sixth session. But had we done the K-5 mandate piece in 2011, in 2 months' time, we'd be having a group of fifth graders coming out of elementary school that have a guarantee as far as humanly possible that they're going to be on grade level for reading and mathematics, and they'd be ready for middle school. As far as I'm concerned in my legislative career, we're 5 years late on this already. It doesn't need to wait. We need to get serious about it. We need to define it. We need to put it in law. And it needs to be a no-cut contract. I talked the other day about flexibility, and my bill tried to enable the maximum amount of flexibility that could be had to provide for innovation and constant improvement. We've met with the House. I hope we can come to an agreement. I think we've come to conceptual agreements on some changes that can be made. I don't ever agree to anything till I see it in writing, but I think that's just good business. And I'll say that from both parties because I think sometimes it can be a misunderstanding. I will say this in terms of the conversations I've had with the House Education leadership. I'm encouraged that the majority of the areas that I have great passion about will be reflected in a revised bill. I did feel like due to questions that have arisen in the past about the validity and reliability of milestones, one reason I put the 30% in there with 20% of it being milestones and 10% of it being other student growth indicators or multiple measures, I think research bears that out, that multiple measures instead of a one-shot, one-day snapshot of one test, multiple indicators is probably a truer reflection of that. I won't die on that hill. I think it's worth consideration. I think it's worth talking about. I don't know that we've completely settled it. If you ask me if I could get everything else in the bill, it was really critical. Would I agree to that? I probably would. I felt like the 20 and 10 was more reflective of that, but everybody that's been around this business knows the legislative process is a process, and there's give and there's take, and you have it doesn't matter how well you run the ball, you need to get over the finish line with it. We need to get over the finish line for the kids in the state of Georgia. We need to quit arguing about adult issues, and we need to talk about kids' issues. And everything in this bill that has to do with the education of a child that's critical to that needs to stay in that bill, and I'll say that. But I'm encouraged by the discussion that we've had. I don't know what the final bill is going to look like. I'm glad we're taking enough time to look at it and try to get it right before we roll out a series of amendments that were written on the back of a napkin, because I think we would be pretty inclined to have an error that we'd have to go back and correct later. And I'm not talking about dragging this around forever. I'd like for this to happen in a day or two. But I think we've got time to do that. I do appreciate the opportunity to bring in the bill. I give you my word. It was the best direction I knew of at the time. It was a result of collaboration with, I guess, all the sectors that I knew of in the education field. I met with a lot of superintendents. I met with a lot of teachers. I met with a lot of organizations, and I asked all of them, if you had a blank piece of paper and a pen, tell me what you think it ought to look like. I guess the reality of this is not everybody got everything they wanted, which probably means it's a pretty good bill. But I'll leave it with that. I look forward to the continued discussion. I don't want to infringe on the time of the people who want to speak to the bill. But
if you'll stay there, we'd like to have some questions for you.
I hope they're not very hard.
I do want to say, Senator, this is the first time I've ever seen a piece of legislation that had, I got that letter, I guess you did, that every organization endorsed, the like you said, it was very, very supportive. All right, it's number 17, first question. All right, now, I'm letting everybody have one question and ask a question. Okay, who's 17? Right. Oh, okay, Representative Sessler, all right. Chairman Sessler.
Mr. Chairman, permit me to ask a long, rambling question then.
No, sir, I won't. you've never done that. No, go ahead.
To my senator, Senator Tippins, you and I have had a number of meetings back in Cobb County with principals, and I so appreciate your efforts on this. I want to get your thoughts on a concern I've shared with you, and we've shared about a hard guarantee for kids to be able to read and do basic math when they leave elementary school, and the flexibility for kids that are struggling there to, I hate to say it, but it's set aside some subjects to ensure they can read and do their required math functions by the end of fifth grade. To me, that was a huge feature of your original bill. And in this negotiated effort of, hey, we're going to add some things that make groups happy and add some extra accountability, wanted you to comment on that. I've got a brother-in-law that teaches in Gwinnett County. Almost half his class is ESOL. And as a fourth-grade teacher, he really struggles to understand why he's teaching certain social studies topics to kids who are really struggling to read. Could you speak to this? And are we going to find a way at the end of the session to get that core part of your bill in?
I certainly hope so, because I think it's critical. I think when you're struggling with an ESOL student at fourth grade level that can't read, and you're trying to teach them social studies and English, and they don't understand it, I'd question the logic of those kind of decisions. As I said before, my bill was built on the premise of flexibility. We got 178 districts out of 180 in the state of Georgia that have flexibility contracts, and there's very little that's sacred that's non-negotiable in those. I think through the creativity, we need to have not only the creativity through a contract, but we need the flexibility in expenditures, and one part of my bill it makes it clear. The number one goal is reading by third grade, and as Chairman Setzler said, we've talked about this before. My end game in this is not to build a fence that a kid can't get past at the end of third grade. My end game is to have a series of formative assessments and a year and a guaranteed annual summative assessment, that there will be no excuse why we didn't know at the end of the first grade that the child was not on grade level, and at the end of the second grade not knowing. And then don't wait till the end of the third grade and say, well, we're going to be hard about this. We're going to retain this kid. We ought not be in the business of retaining kids. We ought to be in the business of educating kids. And the most effective way to do that is through good management. And good management, you've got to know the condition of your kids. And I think the format that I laid out, formative assessments where you have real-time feedback. It's not high-stakes tests, but it's real-time feedback. If you're teaching in modules and you test on module mastery, that builds on a series where you can have a summative assessment. But at the end of the year, you can go down the list of every kid in the first to the second and the third grade. You know where they are on a national norm basis, and you see where they are. And if a kid's not where they need to be, then you know how to direct instruction, and you know how to apply resources. That's good management, folks.
Yeah.
If you think I'm hung up on reading and math, I am. But I've heard people say, don't you care about social studies and don't you care about science? I do. But I'll guarantee you this. If you get reading right, there'll be better science and social studies students.
Yeah. You know, I want to assure y'all, this is one of the areas we're looking about adding back in. But Senator and I have talked about this, and that's the one thing you just said. People, we've known for 50 years how to teach reading. We know how to teach it. I mean, and I sent it to this one, we've had a disagreement. It's not more testing we need, but I agree with you. We need to test them. I'll buy that. But doggone it, what you said, when I've identified that 50%, what are we going to do with them? And I've charged the State Department. I've said, okay, in your contract, if they don't do it, let's find out why those superintendents and those leaders aren't doing it. I agree with you. We got to know who they are, but let's do something with them. All right, next we have number 26. That's okay, Dr. Belton, okay?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. I really do appreciate the math and the English are incredibly important. And also, I want to add about the 2010 thing. The question is, we use MAP at my school, and it's a national test. It's a formative test. It's very, very effective. We really like it. If you had that 30-20-10 thing in there, you could use that. And my question to you, sir, is, isn't it true that the MAP is almost a better test than the milestones?
I'm not a testing expert, but from the feedback I get, MAP is a very effective test because it's a formative assessment, but it also has a conversion component of it that would give you a summative assessment that I'm talking about. It is nationally normed. When you think about now the fact that we do not have a guaranteed analysis of every kid in first and second grade where they are on reading and math, I'm not talking about something that's so onerous a kid's throwing their stomach up for 3 days prior to it. You can do this with relatively simple testing. But we need to know where they are, because there doesn't need to be any excuses from a third or fourth grade teacher about why little Johnny or little Susie's not reading. We need to go back down the data line and look and see where it was that they've fallen off the train. If you know every year, there's not any excuse for that happening. You may be 6 months behind, but you ought not be 3 years behind, and we ought not let that continue.
Again, I want to assure you, that's one area we look at that's coming back. We agree with them, all right? Representative Dickerson, I'm sorry.
Can you all hear me? Okay, am I on? Okay, I think everyone has alluded to the question I was gonna ask, because I looked at the bill, and I think it was section two of your bill. I thought it was really good. I have a sister who's a mathematics teacher and a brother who's been teaching for over 20 years, and those are the things that they have brought to me on the reading and writing, I mean the reading and the mathematics, and I would really like to see that back in the bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That was not a question, Mr. Chairman.
That was just a comment I was making. I said the
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm all in on reading and math. I mean, you can't go to a higher math until you perfect really the one beneath it. My struggle with Section 2 is the fact that we have had this data for years upon years. For, you know, we've been saying we've been should have been doing this 5 years ago, but 5 years ago we had this data. I'm struggling with why perhaps we haven't done anything about it till today, and if we're going to do something about it with Section 2, what is it? Because if it's the retain the student, that's one thing. If it's the, like I said last week, early intervention program, where you put them in the self-contained with a smaller number of students. I'm all in, but I still don't see what the fix is in this language.
The fix is in flexibility with funding. I think you can ask one critical question to any district in the state of Georgia. How many reading diagnosticians do you have? How many reading experts do you have? This, solving a problem is a two-part piece. You've got to define the problem, or you've got to identify that there is a problem. Then you have to define it and figure out what it is. That's the diagnostician part. We talk about one size not fitting all. One size doesn't fit 1,700,000 kids. All kids are not failing to read for the same reason. It may be a dozen different reasons or 50 different reasons. But when we talk about flexibility and putting resources to each child's need, that's what this bill's about, is the flexibility. Now, it's a question of whether a local school board, through their superintendent and through their principals, are going to make it happen. And if it doesn't, shame on them. And I'll say this as a former school board member, shame on the voters for returning them to office if they don't make this a number one priority. This can be done. It's not easy. But school leadership is the biggest part about it. We've had data, but I'm not sure we've had a first and second grade test when you can look back and say, you are the reason this child has made no gain this year, if that's the case. And this is not to be punitive, but if it's a teacher malfunction, we need to be able to identify that. But we need to be able to put resources where the kids have need. All this business is about being kid-focused. This isn't about preserving anybody's realm of influence or power. This is about teaching kids where they got the greatest need. I believe the greatest need in our students today is to get reading and math right by the end of the fifth grade. I think that will effectively solve our dropout program if we do that.
Okay, Senator Tippins, we agree with you. You know, one thing that's interesting, last weekend I met with a teacher, South Atlanta, has 27 children in her first grade. 14 of them she has 14 reading levels in her classroom, 7 languages in her class, and 50% of her children are behind, reading off level. Now, what's she going to do? They won't let her do cross-class grouping. We talked about that. They won't let them do that because of teacher of record, and they don't want to worry about the record keeping. I'm just throwing something, going with Representative Carter, what she's saying. We know, and I'm hoping that the State Department's going to get after these and say, I want to see your plan. I want to see what you're going to do. And you gave a good example the other day from your school system in Cobb when y'all did the cross-grade grouping and how much it improved. So that's one. All right.
Well, let me say this. One benefit of that is y'all just approved 374. This is consolidation of funds. This gives you the flexibility to take all the funds and put them in the areas that you get the greatest return on investment.
Okay. If we help the superintendents and principals to do that. All right. Number 13, Representative Stovall. Last question, okay? Then we're going to let the audience get involved.
All right. Thank you, Senator Tippins. I have a question. I'm not an educator, so maybe when I looked through the bill, I didn't see it. But how is the evaluation done for special needs teachers when it, with all the changes that we're making in here?
I'm going to defer to the DOE. I'm not an expert on that. Y'all want to answer that?
Looking at the evaluation system itself, I mean, teachers will be evaluated the same way. I mean, you look at, I mean, they will be observed, and they will through testing as well. Of course, you have some augmentation. You have to take the IMP or the IEP in consideration as well. But those teachers are just, depending what area they're in, it could be, when you talk about special ed, are you talking about language? Are you talking about speech? And these of natures, in the past, they've had different, speech, different type of evaluation systems built in there. We're looking at, looking at the federal government for some guidance on that, still waiting for a rewrite with there. But, they will be, looked at. They will have that same observation system. I observed many teachers the same way. There was no difference with that. But, looking at, it would have been a slow for that. I mean, they're not necessarily a teacher of record, so, they kind of fall in a different, area of background with that. But those are, some guidelines we have to look at. And I don't know if Dr. McGivney, if you can address that from a special needs area, but, I know IDEA has some different guidelines with that based on what we used to do.
All right, thank you. All right, I have last question, number 10, that's Representative Howard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to piggyback off that question as well. when you're looking at does this put teachers' certifications at risk, on the evaluations?
Right. PSC, yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. So would teachers in low performing schools be rated the same as a teacher in a high performing school?
Well, you're looking at, as far as the testing itself, I mean, you basically have different tiers of performance. I mean, the plan is that if you have low performing or the group of low performing kids, that they would not be compared with a teacher who has high performing kids. So it would be across the state, taking the average and looking at it across the board, that whether I'm in Irwin County and I have a low-performing group, then I would be compared to the low-performing groups across the state. And so, if I have a high-performing group of kids, then it would be a high-performing group that would be compared to as close as possible, apples to apples, but not two different ratings there.
So if a teacher in a low performing school is going to be evaluated on the same, they're being evaluated the same, if I'm hearing you correctly.
I want to say that.
Crossing not necessarily a low performing school, but I think class. You have to look at the class.
The class, right. I understand, right. Yeah. So would this be a deterrent for teachers wanting to go into the low performing schools and teach?
We're trying to compare apples to apples. So, I mean, if it would be a group of low-performing students compared against another group of low-performing students across the state. So it's basically looking at a state average. So it's,
but their certifications are being put at...
And that's for even higher performing as well.
Exactly right.
So, I mean, it is a potential there, yes, sir.
All right. And as Chairman Dixon said, with this district teacher evaluation already is accepted, already is affecting that. All right. Now we're going to get to the your part. So we have 39 or 4?
28.
Okay, how many? 28? Okay, we're going to give you 3 minutes, and then if there's someone that really needs a question, you can ask a question. Now we're going to hold you when you don't, no comments to these people, but you can ask a question. But we have you'll have 3 minutes. We're going to start a timer. And so the first one is
Elizabeth Rhodes.
Is Elizabeth here? And following Elizabeth is Chuck Clay and Katie Reeves. That's the first three, so we'll keep you coming, all right? And speak right into the mic where we can hear you, all right?
I'm Elizabeth Rhodes, and I'm speaking for Educators First, and I won't take 3 minutes. But on behalf of Educators First, and in the interest of brevity, and the long line behind me. We urge the committee to approve Senate Bill 364. This is a product of long discussions with Senator Tippins and others concerning the fairness and balance of the current evaluation tool. This bill is a big step forward to make that tool fairer and more balanced. We also support you including Senator Tippins' reading and math suggestions back into this bill. I spent 30 years in elementary and middle school, and there has to be a stopping point where you say this child doesn't read well enough to go on, or this child doesn't know his multiplication facts. So we urge you to add that back in there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next, we have Chuck Clay on deck. Ernie Lee, after Kay. All right.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Chuck Clay here representing the Georgia Education Coalition, which is 11 of the larger, faster-growing systems. I always say we're not against anybody. We're part of the education team on policy. And simply want to add my support and the support of these systems to the effort that's going on. This is the most important bill that we've had for some time in education. And I applaud both sides. We would very much like to see the reading and math sections return. But I also know, Mr. Chairman, it's a work in progress. I always say a perfect compromise. You agree with me on everything. And I've generally found over the years that's not been the course that most actions take. But whether it be via amendment or whether it be a conference committee report, this is vital. And I applaud you for getting a truly seminal and important piece of legislation that really will help those teachers out there on a day-to-day basis in our classrooms. So thank you. Let's get it done.
Next, we have Katie Reeves and Jonathan Loon on deck, all right?
Katie Reeves, I'm on the Fulton County Board of Education, where I've been for the last 18 years. First of all, I want to thank all of you. Thank you, Chairman. Thank the entire Education Committee, and thank you, Senator Tippins. Really appreciate the work. I have to tell you, you know, in the last few years, it's been interesting. For a while, we went through a period where, man, you could find a teacher so easily. The economy was tanking, and everybody decided they wanted to come into education. And we were all of a sudden getting all these great teachers in education. You know, it was really cool. And then all of a sudden, the economy's turned around. We have a massive, massive teacher and leader shortage, education leader shortage in the United States. It's going to get worse. Down the horizon, as you look down the road, people aren't choosing education as a major. So we are really, really struggling to get teachers. And it's actually not all about money. I mean, a lot of what we see in Fulton County is we see the climate and culture. The people stay in education. So many people go to education because it's a passion, because it's their calling. They usually don't go for the money. Money definitely helps. Super duper appreciate, hello? Okay, so y'all don't like me, right? Okay, there we go. I like the light show.
Someone's leaning against the wall back there. Flip the lights back on.
Okay, so in any event, we appreciate the money. We want to pay our teachers. I'm just going to keep going. I have a loud voice, and everybody will hear me anyways. We appreciate the extra money, and our teachers deserve raises after such a long dry spell. But, you know, culture and climate is just as important. And this bill really addresses some of those things. I'll take on our back as a local system that some of that culture and climate, that's on our back. We need to try to do everything we can to make teaching the rewarding profession. And I'm going to use that word again, profession. We have education professionals. Our teachers are professionals. Our education leaders are professionals. And they need to be treated like professionals. And I think that in our zest to really save all of our kids in Georgia and do best by them and put in this accountability measure, I think that we have sacrificed some of the treating our education leaders and our teachers like professionals. This bill goes a long way towards addressing a lot of the issues that we've been hearing in Fulton County for the last couple of years. I really, really appreciate everybody's work on it. And we're available in the light or the dark, should you have any questions. And just as a parting shot, anything you can do to clarify how few SLOs we need, we're all about it. Thank you.
We want to add a new pathway to the curriculum. Light switches, there we go, all right. Okay. All right, Tom, come back up there. Where was the last speaker? No.
My question is just how many former legislators does it take to turn on the lights?
Hey, they were working on it. They were working on it. All right. Next, Mr. Lee is next, then Mr. Loon, and then Sid Chapman will be on deck, all right?
My name's Ernie Lee. I'm a teacher at Windsor Forest High School in Savannah, Georgia, and I'm the 2016 Georgia Teacher of the Year. I appreciate everything you've done. Thank you. I appreciate everything you've done on this bill, and to basically tell you what I've experienced. I've been a teacher now for 6 years. I was a lawyer before I got into teaching, and I made the decision to get into teaching because I wanted to make a difference when I turned 50. So what I have seen is this. The past 5 years, I've had three different principals. When TECAS came in, that was like my first year, and we had a 30% of our faculty leave, and these were senior experienced teachers. Usually teacher attrition is roughly 17%, and that is too high. But I think by doing this bill and making these changes, it's a good start to really giving teachers the respect. The other thing about the evaluations, just to kind of put it into perspective, I have 90 teachers at my school, and if we do 40 to 60 minute observations and then write that up, 20 minutes to put it in, we've got 120 hours and then do that five more times or however many times we do it. We need our administrators to really work with our teachers that need the help. And teachers want accountability. We're not afraid of accountability. We do assessments and testing every day, but just like the classroom, we've got to do it with working with our students, and it has to be fair and it has to be respectful with an eye towards success and growth. And that's what I feel confident about some of the changes that we're seeing. And then the last thing, I guess, respected, well-paid lines of work do not have shortages. And the types of evaluations that we're seeing that we're trying to fix now is a good start to getting there. But teachers I know are dedicated, and they want to do a good job, and we're not afraid of it, but they've just got to be treated better. Thank you.
Thank you so much. All right, Jonathan? Jesse Rush on deck, all right?
All right, good afternoon. Thank you to the chairman and the committee for taking the time to hear from us. My name is Jonathan Leon. I'm a former teacher and teacher leader, both at the elementary school and middle school level. Currently supporting schools all across Georgia implementing a math program. Urging the committee to reconsider SB 364 just for a few reasons. I want to tell you a story about my first year in the classroom, working with a mentor teacher right across the hall from me. This was a teacher who was also a teacher of the year for our school the previous year, was doing an amazing job moving students forward. However, we had a new principal, which is oftentimes the case at our schools, and they did not have the best relationship. So what that meant was because his evaluation was 50% based on this subjective measure that we have, he wasn't given a fair shot and a fair opportunity. So we see a teacher of the year go from exemplary to needs improvement just based on a relationship. I think as we look at this bill and we look over time, we look from 2012 to 2015, 98% of our teachers were either exemplary or proficient. However, we're still graduating at a rate of 72%. I was a math teacher, and that's not adding up to me. What I really do is I appreciate the work that the system is giving to our teacher leaders. However, only two observations given for our tiered approach that we're looking at, that basically could mean, because they haven't been spelled out, a teacher can walk into the classroom two times if they've been deemed proficient or exemplary. That walkthrough will count as their evaluation. And then also there's those two walkthroughs, excuse me. I believe that one of those need to be a formal. We need to sit down, even with teachers who are performing at their peak, and really work on that craft and their growth. Just the last piece is on feedback and mandating that be a part of the process. Anytime that we're training teachers, anytime that we're pushing our student, our teacher leaders, they need to have some sort of feedback so that they know what they need to work on. And right now that's not in the bill. So just, like I said, once again, I appreciate you all hearing this out, but definitely please consider those points to continue to move our students forward, not working through convenience for us adults.
Okay, I think that one comment on the feedback, You do have to sign off on evaluation. There is some feedback there immediately. So hopefully your principal has been doing that with you again.
Some, but you have to request like that formal feedback session. So the point that I'm making is a principal and a teacher need to sit down, talk about the things that they saw. That needs
good
to be
made. Good point. Thank you. Bart? Well, I know. It's in there. Yes, supposed to be. All right. Next we have with Sid Chapman, then Jesse Rush, and Thomas White on deck. All right.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Sid Chapman. I'm the president of the Georgia Association of Educators, which is a state affiliate of the 3 million member NEA. Chairman Coleman, Chairman Tippins, and my esteemed committee members, I want to tell you that I'm really proud of you. I'm really grateful for you. And I'm glad to see that education has been a priority this year. You've had a lot of bills to look at. We support Senate Bill 364. We have included that particular bill in our legislative report card. And as a teacher, I want you to get an A. And so we've talked a lot about testing. So that's what we're here for. We want our legislators to be in tune with what's going on in the schools. GAE supports Senate Bill 364 to update and improve the educator evaluation system to ensure fair, objective, and effective statewide teacher and administrator evaluations. We also support modifying high-stakes student testing, which has created unintended consequences. I have a petition here of about 3,000 educators supporting to improve TEKS, and I'll pass that along to you. We also signed the letter with all the major organizations. Some critical points that we support in 364. It's the lowering of the student growth as measured in standardized tests from 50 to 30. I know there are variations of that, but we would like the 2010. We like that the best, but we're glad to see it's still there. A decrease in the number of state-mandated tests from 32 to 24, and a requirement that evaluations for teachers and administrators can measure that have multiple measures, and, of course, rigorous and what have you. And that there be flexibility with students with cognitive disabilities in the scheduling of assessments. We really like the idea of increasing the attendance to 90%. We think that's great. We like 20.2.940, I think, which adds that in. I'm glad that you're looking at the idea of the evaluation of appealing that to some degree. We already have that if the procedure is bad. But what we are hearing, Mr. Chairman, is that there have been a lot of administrators that have been told, or principals telling other administrators have been told from central office to give only one or twos. And then they don't go back and look at the platform to see if things were followed up with. So if there's some way to maybe add that in or enforce that or what have you, that would be great. And lastly, each of you should have received the letter that, as I said, that we support the fixing of the TEKS bill. We implore you to vote for this bill with 30%. Here's my petition if you would like it. I know you've already gotten the letter. That's 3,000 educators. And so we appreciate you. Usually I get in trouble. But I'm thankful that I'm not the one in trouble today. usually if I'm saying something, it's to your face. I hope you appreciate that in me. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. Next we have Jesse Rush and then Thomas White and Lena White.
Hi, my name is Jesse Rush. I'm a Uniserve director with GAE, so I work in the field directly with 13 different school districts. I want to thank you for your work on this and just share a few stories with you. TEKS has really been implemented differently across the state from district to district, even from school building to school building within the same district, and even with administrators in the same building. I have seen teachers get a 3 on a standard from one evaluator with some commentary and get a 4 from a different evaluator on the same standard with the exact same commentary. So it just varies so much. I think Starla has got some a paper for you she's going to pass out. This just goes through one member story during her entire evaluation process last year. You'll see that She received mostly proficients and exemplaries November through January of last year. Then she had three observations in 1 week and received mostly needs developments, a few proficients and one ineffective. This would be a procedural issue with the way that it was conducted, but this just shows you in her summative assessment, she did receive a needs development, so it was reported to the PSC, so this does impact her certificate. I do want to share with you this story. Just yesterday, I met with a teacher. She had 5 out of 6 observations as of February 9th of this year, received all proficient and exemplaries. She's a 10-year veteran, has very stellar evaluations over 10 years. She put in for a transfer on February 10th of this year. February 12th, she had an observation, and they've conducted 2 additional observations. So now she's had a total of 8 observations this year. And the 3 that were conducted after she put in for a transfer, she received 10 needs development and only 7 proficients. So I hate to say that. It is used in a punitive manner in some places. And I would even say in this school district, there are buildings that are doing it very well. This just is one case. So it varies really everywhere. I appreciate the language that you put in around the grieving procedural deficiencies. We are missing the enforcement language.
Time's up, so kind of summarize it, okay?
Okay, we're missing the enforcement language, and there is a state board rule that says if you're grieving the process, you're ultimately grieving the rating as well. So that would keep us from doing anything there. And I understand that all the issues will not be addressed in this one bill, and I hope that we'll push for continuous improvement of the evaluation system as we do our teachers. And I strongly urge you to look at delaying or eliminating the negative consequences for the needs development until we're able to address some of the issues that we've seen with the process.
Thank you. All right, next we have Thomas White, and I think it's Lonnie. Elaney White is in, and Angela Palms on deck, all right?
Mr. Chairman, representatives, my name is Thomas White. I'm neither a teacher nor am I affiliated with the school system. I'm a corrections officer, but I'm also a concerned citizen of the state of Georgia. For the past few years, the state has attempted to correct issues with Georgia school systems by increasing teacher accountability and implementing standardized tests designed to measure proficiency and ensure student readiness. These measures have only served to create an environment in which teachers are no longer allowed to teach. Under the current system, pressure is placed on classroom teachers to prepare students for periodic state and local assessments. While this may seem like a valid plan, it severely limits the ability of the teacher to provide differentiated, personalized instruction that would meet the individual needs of their students. Instead, teachers are left with no choice but to teach to the test, a practice that almost every expert in institution of higher learning readily condemns. They are told to forsake creativity, abandon sound judgment, and adopt poor practices just so they can prepare students for a test that will not accurately reflect academic proficiency. SB 364 takes real steps to fix the problem. It reduces pressure on teachers and administrators to cater their curriculums to strictly align with a standardized test. It gives the classroom back to the teachers, allowing them to provide creative, personalized instruction that meets the needs of every student. Most of all, it creates a classroom environment that encourages learning instead of fostering an environment shadowed by the looming threat of a failed test. Representatives, you will be hard-pressed to find a voter in your district that is not concerned with the welfare of Georgia's students. I implore you to listen to their pleas. Stand against the darkness that covers the light of our teachers. Allow them to shine once more. Today, stand with the teachers and with our students. To paraphrase Dylan Thomas, do not go gentle into that dark night.
Thank you, sir.
Rage against the dying of light. I couldn't remember for a second. Sorry.
Good.
Maybe I need to go back and take a test. I don't know for just a second.
That was your exemplary evaluation. All right.
It wasn't on the test.
All right. Next. All right. Angela Palm, you're on deck. All right.
Members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to discuss an issue that is near and dear to my heart. I have the privilege of teaching Georgia's third graders. These third graders are transitioning.
Please speak right into the mic. We're having a little trouble, difficulty hearing you.
These third graders are transitioning out of second grade and are first-time standardized test takers. The milestones is completely foreign to them, and it is my job to teach them the standards that third grade requires while also preparing them for the realities of this test. For the first time, they are expected to pass a single test that should measure what they have learned throughout the school year, but this assessment often fails to complete this objective. While students need a measure of growth and teachers do need to be held accountable for the learning of students in their care, teachers across the state have made their voices heard to let you know that this accountability measure should be fair for all of those involved. I have 1 year to cover all of the third grade standards. The curriculum is organized to ensure that all students and standards are thoroughly taught, well advanced in the milestones. However, what happens if a student enrolls in my classroom during the middle of the school year due to a family move? What happens if a student is facing a childhood illness that requires absences periodically to treat that illness? What happens if a family faces a hardship that requires absences? Regardless of circumstances, all of these students will take a similar summative assessment at the end of the school year, and the content that was taught and missed will still be on that test. Currently, my overall evaluation includes the results of all students who were enrolled for at least 65% of the course, but they were still tested on 100% of the standards. Under Senate Bill 364's current wording, only the results of students who have attended at least 90% of the school year will be included in my evaluation, because students who miss more than 10% of the instructional time will miss valuable content. I encourage you to maintain the minimum attendance requirement at 90% of the instructional year. SB 364 is a step towards improving education in the state of Georgia. Thank you. Thank you for making this change for educators and students, and thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. And Dan Jacobs is on deck, as well as Michelle Willis. All right. Angela Palm.
Yes. I have a handout.
All right. Okay.
I will be short. I'm Angela Palm with the Georgia School Boards Association, and GSBA supports Senate Bill 364. We believe there should be more flexibility in the number of observations that are required. We believe the percentage that student growth counts should be decreased. First of all, because there, as we all know, there are so many factors that affect a student's score on a test, on the standardized test. And second, in practical terms, from time to time, we change the standards and assessments. When we do that, we typically have a hold harmless period. Mm-hmm. And if 50% of the evaluation is based on the student growth, we're going to be suspending a large portion of what we're evaluating somebody on. So it makes more sense to decrease that portion of it so it's more spread out for that time period. We believe that we need a thorough review of our assessment program. This is a start with this bill, but particularly in light of the new federal changes, we need to take a look at the whole thing and create a comprehensive plan. We oppose adding an appeal to the process. What you have in the substitute is fine. And one of the reasons I wanted to give you the handout was I went through the state board rule and the state law outlining the steps that are required for the evaluation. And I actually didn't remember that this was in the state board rule, but the very last paragraph there in the box section highlighted in yellow, in the state board rule currently, it says that if there's a procedural violation, that they can have a hearing officer or the local board or other appropriate official to look at it and see if it would have affected the evaluation. So the state board rule already actually does include a process or something. I don't know if the guidelines further expand on that, but I wanted to let you know that that is in there. And thank you for your favorable consideration of Senate Bill 364.
Thank you so much. All right. Next we have, okay.
Good afternoon. My name is Diane Jacoby, and today I am representing the almost...
Speak right into your mic.
My name is Diane Jacoby, and today I'm representing the almost 230,000 members of Georgia PTA. First, we would like to thank Senator Tippins for bringing forth this bill and addressing this important issue, and also we want to thank you for all of your time this afternoon. Georgia PTA supports assessments that are designed to improve teaching and learning and believes that high-quality assessments provide valuable information to parents, teachers, school leaders about the growth and achievement of their students. Assessment is a process of gathering information to guide educational decisions. A test is only one tool that can be used in a comprehensive assessment system to evaluate student growth and learning and teacher effectiveness. Georgia PTA also believes that neither one test nor a single data point should ever be used as the sole determination of a student's academic or career path, such as graduation, admission, retention, or tracking. Nor do we believe that a single data point should be used as the greater part of a teacher's or administrator's evaluation. Georgia PTA supports the language in Senate Bill 364 that reduces the percentage of testing used in teacher evaluations to 30% and in administrator evaluations to 40%. The current use of test scores for 50% of teacher evaluations and 70% of administrator evaluations places far too much emphasis on test scores and does not acknowledge other aspects of effective teaching. These high percentages also do not recognize other factors beyond a teacher and school's control that can impact a student's learning and academic growth. Georgia PTA supports high-quality assessments aligned with state standards that include multiple measures of student growth and achievement and can assist in identifying the resources and supports both students and schools require. However, Georgia tests our children at 3 times the federal requirement, and Georgia PTA supports reducing the amount of tests our children are forced to take. The average 7th grader spends almost a month taking milestones, SLOWs, surveys, and other state or district-required assessments. This month does not include the amount of additional instruction time used to prepare for these tests. Less testing and a lower emphasis on test scores and evaluations will result in more quality instruction time, which in turn will increase the learning opportunities for Georgia students. Georgia PTA asks for your support of Senate Bill 364 and reducing the amount of testing and the weight of those tests in teacher and administrator evaluations. Please allow our students and educators to focus on instruction and learning instead of test preparation and test taking. Thank you for your positive consideration of Senate Bill 364 and your service to the citizens of Georgia.
Thank you. All right, next we have Michelle Willis, then we have Aaron Baker and Jane Howe.
Good afternoon. I've got my timer. 2 minutes.
Oh, good. All right. That's very good. Hey, I'm impressed. All right.
The teacher, come prepared. Thank you so much for Senator Tippins for State Bill 364. My name is Michelle Willis, and I have been in public education for almost 20 years. Although I'm an educator, I want to speak to you from the perspective of a parent, of a child who carries the burden of some learning and attentional deficits. Sorry. He attends a wonderful public school and has always had excellent teachers. All of them have modeled good teaching. They pre-teach and pre-assess. They teach to various learning styles and differentiate. They modify, they accommodate, they diagnose, they intervene, they reassess, they reteach, they reevaluate, and reflect and reteach again. They communicate with me. They are responsible for his safety and his well-being daily. They nurture him both academically and socially. And they do this 180 days per year. They do all of this with large class sizes. They do this because they are professionals who are passionate educators. They are my son's greatest ally. Does all of this daily blood, sweat, and tears from an educator sound to you like one quarter to one half of their job should be evaluated based on one high-stakes test? It is appalling to me that if my Sam isn't paying attention, gets confused, gets some anxiety, and doesn't test well, that he could have a negative impact on the very people that have put their hearts and souls into him every single day. As a politician, you may ask, well, how would we know where Sam stands educationally without high-stakes testing? Well, I can tell you because his teachers tell me, and he tells me. He is on level in math, he is above level in reading, and he is slightly below level in writing. How do I know this? I know this based on growth model assessments that his teachers implement throughout the school year. None of this information comes from any high-stakes testing. An example, yesterday Sam comes home. His reading Lexile was 525. He said, Mommy, I met my goal. I'm at 650. He knew. And I as a parent have the responsibility to take the information that the teachers give me and use it at home. The parent is an integral part of the child's education, and if they are not being held accountable, how can you hold a teacher accountable on one test that is not even a growth model assessment? Teachers don't mind being held accountable. We are held accountable every moment of every day. It just should be reasonable accountability. Even at 30%, if you don't lower the percentage of teacher evaluations tied to testing, my deduction is, that attrition rates will rise, losing great teachers, and teachers that stay will become jaded and less effective. Please, you have the power to stop this high-stakes testing madness. We hope that you consider this. Thank you.
Hey, your time is right on time. Thank you so much. Thank you. All right, next we have Aaron Baker, Jane House, and Margaret Ciccarella.
Good afternoon. Thanks so much for your time today. My name is Aaron Baker. I have been an educator or studying to be an educator for half of my life. I have taught high school English in both Gwinnett and Cobb counties and am currently serving my fifth year as the media specialist at Durham Middle School in Acworth. I am also a resident of Acworth and have two children, a kindergartner and a second grader attending Pickett's Mill Elementary. I'm here today to speak on behalf of the students and teachers of Georgia regarding the excessive number of standardized tests currently in place within our schools. I implore you to minimize the obstacle to learning that standardized testing has become and to make the changes necessary to allow our primary focus to be on teaching and learning. Georgia schools are currently administering three times the number of standardized tests as are mandated by the federal government. This equates to weeks of standardized testing. While students are taking tests, they are obviously not engaged in learning. You may not be aware that since most of these assessments are required to be taken on hardwired computers, they essentially shut down our computer labs and on many occasions, even our media centers for weeks at a time, making these resources unavailable to our students and teachers. Over the years, I have witnessed myriad student responses to standardized testing. On one end of the extreme are students for whom these assessments cause undue anxiety, panic attacks, physical illness, vomiting, and stomach and headaches. In the majority middle are the students for whom they have grown completely desensitized to this test because of their frequency. On the other far end are the students for whom these measures hold little meaning or value at all. I have heard students express just that they don't care. And I've witnessed Christmas treeing of Scantrons and students speeding through computer-based tests, obviously not even reading the questions or passages. Those kids quite obviously don't care if the tests are used to determine the quality of their teachers' efforts, nor if they guide curriculum choices or practices. And why should they? It's not their job, their career, their livelihood, or necessarily their future on the line if they fail to succeed. This is the reality of standardized testing. In a recent symposium titled New Learning for a Rapidly Changing World, Stanford Graduate School of Education professor Linda Darling Hammond addressed the need for schools to prepare students for the changing world, explaining that two-thirds of children in school today will enter jobs that do not yet exist using technologies that have not yet been invented to solve complex problems we have not solved. Therefore, instruction must be designed such that students master problem solving, working in teams, and communicating effectively. Bubble tests do not measure these skills. As a parent and educator, I also know that high-stakes tests represent very little of what students are capable of accomplishing. They so rarely indicate their talents, work ethic, drive, perseverance, determination, kindness, compassion, and worth as human beings. They cannot foreshadow the impact one individual can have on the world. They are simply theoretical measurements of ability, nothing more, and should be used minimally as a guide and in a way that does not interfere with student learning. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, on deck we have, and I want to be sure I get this one right.
Cecily Harsh Kimmy.
Kenny, it looks like you're on deck. Cecily. All right. This next we have Jane Howe. Okay, Jane.
Good afternoon. My name is Jane Howe, and I'm with Tragic. I'm a retired educator, speech and language pathologist. In North Carolina, a crisis in education is taking place. Enrollment in education majors is in rapid decline in the state which produced the highest performing teachers in the country. The University of North Carolina has just been named the number one public university in the United States, yet the elementary, middle, and high schools that feed into UNC are in serious trouble. There is a growing exodus of teachers from the teaching profession. In Kansas, they can't find enough teachers to fill the classrooms. Why? Low pay, revenue cuts, and job protection removed. The superintendent of Hays County, Kansas schools says, teachers face constant bashing from the governor and legislature, who, in my opinion, are trying to privatize public education and destroy it. In Louisiana, 10 years after Hurricane Katrina, New Orleans' all charter school system has proved a failure. In a study by the Network for Public Education, researchers found that in Louisiana, public schools outperformed charter schools, and the gap was the largest of any state in the nation. Louisiana's scores overall were fourth from the bottom in the United States. These are the states where the legislatures did not listen to the teachers, parents, and members of the education community. They turned a deaf ear, they turned their backs, and their schools have been destroyed. But in Georgia, our legislators are starting to listen. With Senate Bill 364, you are taking the high road, and where children are involved, we must always, always take the high road. By listening and taking action, you are showing us that you want Georgia to be a state that cares about all of her children, rich, poor, white, black, Hispanic, Asian, gifted, and disabled. You show us that you want Georgia to be a state that values her teachers by making it a place where teachers want to teach and treating them fairly. Your willingness to hear us out gives us hope that you won't let Georgia become another state in educational crisis like North Carolina, Kansas, and Louisiana. You are proving to us that you are willing to be courageous and do the right thing, and that you understand that the number one factor, and research backs this up, that makes a difference in the classroom is not test scores, but a qualified, well-trained teacher. I wish to specifically thank Senator Tippins, Representatives Coleman, Dudgeon, and Dixon, and all of the committee for listening and taking action on behalf of the children of Georgia.
Thank you. Next, we have Margaret Ciccarelli, and we have Carolyn Wood. You'll be on deck along with Chris Cannon, all right?
I'm Margaret Ciccarelli from PAGE, the Professional Association of Georgia Educators, representing over 91,000 Georgia educators. We want to thank you for the consideration of the bill. We strongly support it and hope that you will work with Chairman Tippins regarding any differences after today. Unhappiness with testing, as you know and as you've been hearing about at this meeting, is driving teacher attrition with Georgia and parent and student dissatisfaction with our schools. We think the bill is an important first step in dialing down the emphasis of testing for students, but it is only a start. We need an audit of testing in Georgia at both the state and local levels. We've had confusion already in today's meeting about just what state-required testing is happening in our schools. We understand that there is an audit underway, or it will soon be underway, and we know the chairman has expressed interest in meetings this summer to discuss testing. We hope to participate and partner in those meetings. The bill also continues to refine the good work that was started with Georgia's current teacher and leader evaluation system. It de-emphasizes testing and emphasizes professional growth. It allows local systems flexibility to implement evaluation systems in the best ways. I want to leave you with this point. Professional educators are not afraid of accountability or of testing, but they want to be held accountable for the right things, and they want their students to be tested in appropriate ways. Thank you so much for hearing this bill today. We hope that you will pass it today and that we can work with the Senate on any differences. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Okay. On deck, hey, we get into the second sheet. Jimmy Stokes, you're on deck.
Good afternoon. My name is Cecily Harsh-Kanane, and I'm here on behalf of Southern Education Foundation and Public Education Matters Georgia, a statewide parent organization. And I would just like to say we are in full support of this bill, and thank you all so much for the efforts to reduce the emphasis on testing and to reduce the punitive effect of what we've done to emphasize testing on teachers. So the 30%, I think, is an important step. I will say that I did like the 2010 also, because I think to have the multiple indicators probably does give a truer and fairer read of the teacher's effect on that student and what the student really is learning in that classroom, which is what we really want to do. I think the de-emphasizing and the allowance for the lessening of slows is wonderful. I will say, I think Representative Belton, your point was a great point about whether the taking away the science and social studies in 3-5, where we have departmentalized classrooms, and we're going to still need to have a growth measure in there for those teachers' evaluation, it does leave open the possibility for more slows in there. So I think that's a great point that I hope y'all consider how to address that. The other point, the difference between the two bills, and I think it's been stated already, but I'll just say we support this also. I think the adding back in the K through 5 formative assessments to make certain that kids really are where they need to be reading and math-wise as they go off to middle school, because, you know, I think that's the best way to make certain that if kids do need extra support in those areas, that we get that support before they go on to higher levels. So it's been said that it's going to be added back in there. I think that's an important piece. Another important, really important piece of this bill that hasn't been talked about much today, that Representative Dudgeon talked about when he presented it, but I think the reliability and validity piece about having that audit in there to make certain these tests really are doing and are research-based, you know, to make certain that we're really doing what we want to do in terms of measuring this. So thank y'all once again. I will just say in closing, I wanted to thank Senator Tippins and thank y'all on the House Education Committee. I think y'all really taken a huge step towards changing the discussion about testing for testing's sake to testing for kids' sake. So thank you very much. That's really important, and we really, really wholeheartedly thank you for that. One other thing, Carolyn Wood is not going to talk because of the importance of time. So thank y'all again.
All right. It's Chris Cannon. Chris Cannon, not here. Not here. Okay, let's go to Jimmy Stokes.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I'm Jimmy Stokes. I represent the Georgia Association of Educational Leaders. We enthusiastically support Senate Bill 364, and we appreciate the changes that you have made in the bill. But we earnestly and humbly ask that you reconsider the grades 3-5 math situation, math and language arts situation, and in working with Senator Tippins to restore that. Senator Tippins said there's no such thing as a perfect bill, but folks, Senate Bill 364 is a major step toward making evaluation, assessment, and testing reasonable. One of the great tests of law is the test of reasonableness. This has an opportunity to move toward reasonableness. Several years ago, we instituted TEKS and LEAKS and the testing program that we have now. And like many of you, I have purchased cars thinking that they were the very best automobile that I could afford. But folks, it's time to trade the orange Pinto station wagon for a Cadillac. We support Senate Bill 364. We salute Senator Tippins, and we salute you for your courage in the face of political adversity to consider this bill. Thank you on behalf of the children of Georgia.
Thank you. All right. Marcus Blackwell, you're next. Connie Jackson, you're on deck. Kelly Brock, you're third.
All right. Good afternoon, members of the committee. My name is Marcus Blackwell, founder of Make Music Count, the mathematics curriculum taught through music. And I wanted to just emphasize and for you all to reconsider the need for 90% attendance of students in the classroom in order to be put on teachers' evaluation. And the reason for that is because if you think about 90% or missing that 10%, it's really not allowed when you consider health issues that can come up, and most importantly, suspension. And for those students that are suspended, my fear is that the incentive to reach back out to them to help them get better will obviously be decreased slightly. And it's a little bit unfair because those students are still required to then take those tests that all the other students are needed to take as well. And so I just wanted to just emphasize that, hey, you know, Things happen, and a lot of the students go through a lot in school, and at times they'll miss more than that 10% in the classroom. And so if the students are going to be required to be evaluated, then so should the teachers. And, you know, at the end of the day, the question really is, you know, do you really need the 90% to be effective? And you really don't. I mean, because I tell you one thing, students know when you care. And so if you're not really putting in that effort that you would, knowing you'll be evaluated, there will be some difference in how you reach out to them. So thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. All right. Next, we have Connie Jackson.
Good afternoon. Connie Jackson, president of the Cobb County Association of Educators, and also special education.
Speak right in your mic.
Special education. Connie Jackson, president of Cobb County Association of Educators, and special education teacher in Cobb County. First, I just want to thank Senator Tippins. This is an amazing bill. We are so excited about it. We have longed for a bill like this. I think that this is much needed. We would love to see this enacted this year and ready for next year, you know, as we go back to school. Cobb is in a unique position that we really have not had too bad a teacher shortage, but I see it coming. You know, I think it's all over the state, and it is going to hit us. And we're worried about that. I think this bill will go a long way into fixing a lot of those problems. I think that, you know, we really, as a lot of people have said, you know, it's not about money, it's about climate, and it's about, you know, job and satisfaction. We love the students, that's why we teach, but when the pressure and all of the other things seem to be stacked against you, you really don't enjoy doing your job anymore, and that's a shame. As a special education teacher, there's a lot of other factors that go into it, and the testing becomes a lot different than just administering tests. We have read-to tests. We have students who have, you know, a lot of other issues with the tests. And if you think administering a test to a class of general education teacher students is one thing, but administering them to students who you have to read to them and they have a lot of other issues, it becomes a whole different atmosphere. And when you stack those tests one behind another, behind another, behind another, it's a different matter. So I would encourage you, as we wrap up, you know, all the things that everybody else has said, to please include the part for the elementary students. It is so critical. When I get sixth graders who read at a first grade level, it, even if in special education, it really makes it tough. And I would encourage you to please keep the 90% in special education. It is so critical that they have that attendance piece and all of the others. I would also encourage you to keep the 30% and the 40%. That makes a huge difference to us as educators. I encourage you to please pass this bill. We'd love to have it in place for next year. Thank you again.
Thank you. All right, Kelly Brock, and we have Sita Cook on deck. Michael O'Sullivan, you're next after her. After Sita. All right.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Kelly Brock, and I live in Habersham County. I have spent 15 to 20 years in public education as a special education teacher, and I'm currently a teacher at Brenau University working in the College of Education. The bill before you today is comprehensive, and it's important. There's a lot of really great things to continue an educational dialogue on, but I'd like to focus on just one very, very small piece of it. The challenges of designing and implementing a protocol for teacher observations are great. There's such a human aspect to this process that we automatically have to allow for some variations in how these processes are implemented. For our Georgia teachers that are rated proficient or exemplary and thus are subject or may be subjected to a lesser amount of observations throughout the school year, I would ask that you please ensure that at least one of those observations are clearly of a formative nature and will also measure and observe the teacher against all the standards of standards of practice. But none of the observation process is meaningful without some really good after observation feedback. I encourage you to strengthen the current language of the law that a teacher can request, may request an after observation conference to something that allows them to be sure that they're going to receive this important information. I've taught in schools in the state of Texas, I've taught in schools in our nation's capital, I've taught in schools in Maryland, and never ever did I ever teach in a school that I was not guaranteed a post-conference talk with my principal, who was able then to help guide me in my professional growth, to help guide me with areas that I needed strengthening in, and we all have them. It's a process of continuous improvement. It also strengthened my relationship with the principal so that I would then have more of a common goal and a common vision with that principal in implementing instruction for our students. We owe it to our kids to have teachers who are made aware of their professional development needs. We owe it to our kids to have teachers who are valued for their demonstrated talents and knowledge. And we owe it to our kids to have teachers who are then inspired to engage in continuing personal growth so that we are always keeping the needs of our students and our teachers in mind. I appreciate your hard work. It's been very difficult, and I just encourage the dialogue to continue.
We have a question for you.
Okay.
Representative Carter?
Sorry. Regarding conferences with the administrator, and I don't have the language in front of me that we passed several years ago regarding this, but at my school where I teach, I have a mid-year conference and an end-of-year conference with my administrator.
Excellent.
And I thought I remembered that being in the language.
It was.
Is that not happening all the schools?
It's my understanding that the no, it's not happening at all the schools. But it's my understanding the language merely says that teachers may request a conference after their observation. But it is not happening in all the travels of schools that I do evaluations of. It's unfortunately not a common practice.
Okay, thank you. All right, next, any other, all right, next presenter we have is, let's see, Cedar Cook. Okay. Cook, all right, yeah, there you are, hey there. And then Michael O'Sullivan, you're next, followed by Ron Mahoney.
I purposely waited to sign up so I could maybe say, oh, they've already done it, or at least to stick to something I haven't said and nobody else has said before. So I have only a few comments. One is, as a historian and social studies teacher, that I think that what we clearly need to do, whoever is capable, is to work in the early grades with those who are still reading, and maybe with the ninth graders who are still learning to read, how to blend social studies issues in with that, so that whether it should, social studies should never be rote learning, it should never be the way it's often taught. And so I just hope that we don't say that we can throw out social studies because we have to focus on reading instead of having them work together. That a lot of what teachers, students, parents have been upset about is a combination of the standardized aspects, the multiple choice, but above all, the high stakes part of it. And that's what causes so much pressure. So any way all of this can be done, so there are multiple assessments, multiple whatever, flexibility, that's really good. To put this in historical context, I have what at this point is a three-page chronology that I've been working on off and on the history of high-stakes testing. It starts in the year 2200 BCE, when the Chinese imposed a written test to determine who could be a civil servant. So that's rather high stakes. And there's been patterns going back and forth. In the 1880s, the pattern tended to be for public schools that promotion to the next grade would be based more often on exam scores than on the personal recommendations of teachers. Some superintendents complained about this, and many people began criticizing using the phrase teaching to the test. So that this is a long-term problem. people have solved it at times and then gone backwards on it. But that doesn't mean we can't do a lot better. And then finally, as you know, and some people have alluded to, passing the bill and getting it signed are only the first steps. I appreciate the way throughout this process, and it's not the first time, but it's been especially good, that the legislators in both of these committees have worked with the Department of Education, organizations, odd people like me who don't fit in any of the other categories. Let's keep working together, including helping districts do all of this correctly. So all the examples that have come up about it's supposed to be this way and it's not, that any there should be a process to help the DOE find out what is going on, and not enforcing in a policing sense, but in a supportive sense, so that you don't just pass something wonderful that isn't put into practice as it should be. So thank you for all of this.
Thank you. All right, next we have Michael. Then Shamita Johnson, you'll be after Ryan Mahoney. All right.
Good afternoon. I'm unfortunately here to oppose this legislation that, as it's currently been written. I do so because it does fail to abide by what research has shown to be an appropriate, accurate, and predictable range for what constitutes the amount of student growth. It has been stated that, 30% was decided because it was arbitrary. It was picked because some wanted it more and some wanted it less. I think something as important as this shouldn't be left to just arbitrary. We know that effective teachers can and do have a direct impact on the lives of their students. A highly effective teacher, can gain, their students can earn an extra half year of learning for each time that they are enrolled in one of those teachers' classrooms. Research has shown that teachers with high student growth scores have a long-lasting financial impact on their students. Research has also shown that highly effective teachers improve the likelihood of getting into college, of creating a steeper earning trajectory. And research has provided proven benchmarks for how reliable systems should be designed, and that range is between a third and a half. And Georgia is moving from the top end of that range, and I understand the reason to move down, but we're not only nearing the bottom, but we've gone below it. That being said, evaluations are based on multiple measures, more than just test score, and so there's a couple other areas of the bill that I'm going to address as well. Observations, we support a tiered observation system as it's currently out here. I would say that it would probably be more ideal if the State Board or Department were to design what that looks like. The State Board is currently piloting a modified observation system. Our concern is just ensuring that teachers are routinely observed, and there's currently no actual minimum that's being left in the bill. Observations should be meaningful. There should be emphasis on feedback and ways to improve. I think the issue about conferences, the bill requires a mid-year and an end-of-year conference. I think the issue is that a conference should occur at the time that the observation is finished. If there is meaningful feedback, that should occur at that point and not wait until the end of the year. And finally, there is some concern on our part about what the professional growth will look like, how it will be developed, and then the timeline of all of this being implemented before the 2016 school year. There is a lot that local districts have to do. There's a lot of policies that need to be developed. Implementation is important, and we need to make sure that's being done right. So I appreciate the time today.
Thank you so much. All right. Next presenter, and our last presenter, Carl Mercer. Come on up there. We want to see where you are. Carl Mercer, you'll be the last presenter. But Ryan, if you'll come on up. Ryan Mahoney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Ryan Mahoney with the Foundation for Excellence in Education. As many of you know, we work on a range of best policies in education across the country and, of course, right here in Georgia. We really appreciate the thought and the effort that's gone into this bill. And we wanted to commend you for the substitute, which we believe addresses the concerns that we and others have raised about the impact of the bill on assessments in Georgia. We share the committee's goal of having fewer and better tests in Georgia. In fact, our organization actually came up with that phrase, fewer better tests, some years ago. Tests are part of life. You have to take a test to get a driver's license. You have to take a test to get into college or to get a job. But having too many tests, or tests that measure things that aren't actually important to student success, or tests that take inordinate time away from instruction, or that cost inordinate amounts of money, those sorts of tests serve no purpose. Tests should be rigorous and comparable from school to school, and they should be giving educators and parents and policymakers like yourselves the information that they need to make informed decisions to help student achievement. When we reviewed the prior version of SB 364, we were concerned that instead of fewer better tests, it would actually result in more costlier and inferior tests. The prior version would have created a host, or at least have created an environment in which there could have been a host of new assessments in various grades in different districts across the state of Georgia. There was very little mention of how these assessments would be used, or language to ensure that they would be of high quality and comparable across districts. There would have been significant additional costs associated with these tests for both local districts and for the state. Valuable time would have been spent by teachers and staff administering these tests, grading these tests, and by students in preparing for and taking these tests. And finally, the prior language would have directly violated the federal Every Student Succeeds Act, ESSA, just recently passed. I think we can all agree that what comes out of Washington is not always wisdom these days, but regardless of how we may feel about the new federal law, it does expressly require that the same assessment be administered to all students in grades 3 through 8 in the state. And it sets a very high bar for high schools that on an individual basis wish to substitute alternative assessments for their students, a bar that we do not believe SB 364 in its prior version met. And while it does allow states to roll up multiple interim assessments into a single summative score, which we commend, as this is a great step toward competency-based education, which we fully support, the Governor's Commission and many of you also support, it does not allow states to do the same thing with formative assessments, which is what the prior language would have done. Again, thank you to the committee for resolving these important issues. We hope that the new language will carry forward through the House floor and through any conference committee that may be appointed.
Thank you so much. Now we have Shamita Johnson, all right?
Bonjour. Comment allez-vous? Très bien.
Habla espanol.
Good afternoon, House Education Committee, leaders, educators, and all. My name is Shamita Johnson, as was just mentioned. I'm a world language educator that was recruited from the international development field from an organization such as Save the Children. I want to just take a moment of your time to tell you how my career was negatively impacted as a 13-year educator. I created an international academic exchange program for my middle school students based upon research I did toward my doctoral studies and the need I saw for my students. I was approved by my former district to take my students from the south side of Atlanta Public Schools during the midst of an ongoing shooting at the campus to overseas to Nancy, Metz, France during the summer of 2013, for which I was able to establish through a partnership with the school in France through the French government, the Ministry of Education. I was also able to take students from the north side of Atlanta Public Schools, International Baccalaureate School, to Toulouse, France, in the summer of 2015 for an international academic exchange program with a partner school in France that I established again through the French government, for who bestowed upon me as a cultural knight of education. Yes, the international academic exchange programs were a success for these students, for which I am the only educator in the state of Georgia and in the United States with this type of program. How do I know that the international academic exchange program was a success? It was because my students returned to the classroom with the highest scores on their SLOES tests at my school. But my career was negatively impacted because the Atlanta Public Schools Board voted to have me removed from the system on Monday, March 7th, 2016. And the PDP, TEKS, and whatever else was used to remove me, even though I was an exemplary teacher under three principals, for the past 12 years of my academic career, my educational career. But when I was transferred to the north side of Atlanta Public Schools, I went to needs improvement in my 13th year. And even though I came with the same fight for students and all the things that goes into the daily life of an educator, I was still removed. However, I am grateful to God that I had the opportunity to go overseas to study and do research as a student and as a professional over the course of more than 10 years before joining the educational field to give back to society. And while I do have a plethora of offers from international baccalaureate schools overseas and across the U.S., I'm dismayed that I had to endure this pain. So I just thank you for giving this opportunity to everyone to speak. So thank you.
Thank you. Now, last presenter this afternoon will be Carl Mercer.
First of all, thank you for this time. I'd like to thank Senator Tippins, Superintendent Woods for their support. I'd also like to thank this committee for hearing and considering this bill. I just want to make sure there's a couple things that everybody understands and that we have straight before you guys make a decision on changing language or approving. One, SLOs are a mandated assessment at all levels, at all grade levels, because we have teachers that don't teach a state mandated assessment. We have art teachers, special teachers, et cetera. In Forsyth County, which I'm the Director of Accountability in Forsyth County, we gave 110 SLOs last year to meet our one measure per teacher, and that includes the SGPs. So the 110 didn't meet the one measure. We had the SGPs that did. In order to meet the two measures slated for 17-18, we're in the process of developing 100 more SLOs. So that's over 200 SLOs that we'll have to give. We're in support of less testing. But I will say that with the reduction of science and social studies, that will increase the SLOs for those teachers, especially in elementary schools or high schools or anywhere they're departmentalized, because they will have to have that growth measure that's mandated. There's a large disparity between districts when it comes to SLO development. Yes, they are approved, but they are very different in rigor and content from district to district, but with all of those, everybody is measured on the same TIM and LIM. All growth measures are also lagging data. So the growth measure does not represent the work of the educator in that current year. So you could have an educator do very well with TAPS or LAPS, but be scored low because their growth from the year before that they corrected in the current year has caused that to happen. We support the 90%. These assessments aren't able to be given in one day. They're multiple day assessments, especially with the move to online. So for 80 EOCs, we have about a 15 day window. And for EOGs, we have about a 10 day window. And that's just the reality of the time that's taken. And we also have to kick CTAE courses out so that we can give those assessments using computers and online. So there's a lot that goes into that and the disruption of the day. We try to minimize that, but that's the reality of what happens. And I just, again, like to end with thank you for your time. Thank you for listening. We support the original language of House Bill 364 and hope that you move forward with that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. All right, members of the committee, this concludes our hearings. Is there, before I give you a statement of what our intent is, do any of you have any questions for anyone you'd like to ask? I will entertain a couple of questions. Anyone feels they have a burning question you need to ask at this time? I see no lights. Here's the posture of the committee. I've talked with Senator. I'm going to give you a chance to make a closing. And remember, we love brevity. So you can have a closing statement if you'd like. Thank you. You did a great job. and we appreciate it. Here's where we, now listen very carefully. Here's where we stand. any member of the committee that has a suggestion, would like to discuss anything further, please contact us and let us know anything you want to give us. Give any recommendation you have in writing to Representative Dudgeon. Give him your recommendation or give it to Sheena, my administrative assistant. I'd prefer you give it to Representative Dudgeon if you would. Any comment, anything you feel that you need to, from this meeting you need to. Anyone from the audience, we heard your comments. We have them. Our legislative counsel was over here, Betsy. She heard. She's been very attentive and heard what you said. If you feel, though, there's something you need to put in writing and share, again, to the attention of Representative Dudgeon, or send it to my office, to Sheena, and she will take that. I'll give a light on just a second. Also, you need to know that what we're going to do, I appreciated your comment, Senator. You don't want to rush this thing. You want to be sure you have it just like we feel we need it. So what this committee is going to do, where you'll know, we're not going to take a vote today, but listen, we will meet Friday morning at 8:30 to vote. At that time, now we plan to send out whatever we cometh and going to vote on will be sent to you sometime tomorrow. It will be sent to you tomorrow, hope maybe late, but we plan to send out to all our organizations. You will receive the substitute or whatever we come up with, decide to do. Senator Tippins, that was with what you is that with what you agreed to. Again, 8:30, hopefully in this room here, we will have no comments. We'll come in, questions of Senator Tippins. If there are any questions, we'll look at the changes, if there are any, in whatever we're dealing with, the substitute, and then we will take a vote. All right, I have a question. 17, that is. All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to say for members of the committee, I do know something I'm going to offer to Representative Dudgeon, and I would just ask the members of the committee to consider it. I love my senator, and I don't say this because I like him. I say this because I agree with him. I do think the early grade approach that he took is very important policy.
We agree.
And I would urge you to join me in
support. Well, we've talked about that. That was a lengthy discussion this morning, so we're going to consider. Yeah, that's there, okay? Anybody else have a question? Number two, Representative Carter.
I just want to make a comment that I think this conversation has made me realize I'm in a utopia in Lowndes County, and I do not want all of you to flock to Lowndes County to teach because I'm there and you may not have my job. Thank you.
Yeah, you really are, I tell you. Anyone else on the committee have a question? All right, we have a procedure motion. All right, Representative Dudgeon.
When I was conducting the Senate bills, we didn't become clear on who's carrying them. I did check Lieutenant Governor's office while we were here. So Senator Tippins, okay, 329, I will carry that one. We also passed 374, and I think Representative Belton wanted to carry 374. Is that okay with you, Senator Tippins? And that's also okay with Lieutenant Governor's office. I just want to get that clear for the record for those two bills we passed today.
That clear, okay. All right, any other questions from the committee? We understand. We'll see you at 8:30 here Friday morning. Thank you so much for everyone for all you've done. We appreciate it. Thank you.